Dusa Radio was founded in 2009, and since then has been bringing the students of the University of Dundee truly outstanding music, 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. I am Morgan Freeman, and this is Dusa Radio.
And here we are, Saturday morning again, live on the Minds Matter podcast with the University of Mental Health Society. Dusa, as well as Sports Union, are getting involved in this move. And today we have another special guest, a mental health professional for a long time. Ellie, would you like to introduce our guest?
Hiya, so this is Mike Ramsay. He's a lecturer in mental health nursing here at the University of Dundee.
Morning.
Good morning. So, we've got a full list of questions. We've even got more questions than we did for Tom. We've got a lot of people writing in to ask you a lot of questions. Mm-hmm. You've got some songs for us as well.
Yeah, I do, yeah. I picked 5. They've all got a mental health resonance for me.
Fantastic. That's good. All different?
Yeah, they're all very different.
Can't wait. Would you like to start with a few questions, Ellie?
Fantastic, then. Right, I'll just get straight into, basically, why did you choose mental health nursing as a career, then?
Well, I started out as a general nurse, as we called it then. We now call it adult nursing. But and in second year of my training, I had to go to Sunnyside Royal Hospital in Montrose for a 3-month placement. And mental health nursing was much different then than it is now, because we still had the remnants of the asylum system. We had lots of long-stay patients. And I went to 2 wards when I was there, and I was very, it was hugely different from the general nursing, the very technical nursing I was doing over at Strathro at that time. But I really, really liked it, and I really liked the human contact with the patient group. So I resolved, because it was easier at that time, that when I qualified, I would consider doing my registered mental nurse training, as it was called then. I call it mental health nursing now, but. And so I did. I went to Perth College Nurse and trained at Murray Royal Hospital in Perth to become a mental health nurse on the back of that very interesting and fulfilling experience at Sunnyside in 1985.
Fantastic. Is there any particular case when you were studying for to become a mental health nurse, or even after, that stuck with you and helped you just maintain, you know, why you do what you do?
Yeah. There's probably 2 that come immediately to mind. The first was probably in that student experience in 1985. And there was a long stay resident in the hospital there who had some peculiar behaviours at the best of times, but he became acutely unwell on top of this kind of personality that he presented, this persona that he presented regularly. And he was just the most fascinating case to see. And he was also really difficult to manage. He posed a lot of challenges for the nursing team. But there was inside this tortured soul, there was a man, you know, a very kindly man, actually, who was not really able to always control himself. And I was partly fascinated by it, but partly kind of my heart went out to it. And I thought that was that it tapped into a kind of a side of the compassion that I felt already had, that I never knew, a kind of well of compassion that I never knew I had for somebody. And I didn't even begin to pretend to fully understand what he was going through, but I wanted to understand what he was going through, or to try to. So that sticks out. And another is much more when I was really quite an experienced nurse. I had to see a lady who had a very delayed grief, and I'd been with her for nearly an hour, and we talked around the loss of her partner. I used this expression with students. I took what I thought was the empathic gamble. There was something in what she said that I thought, I kind of missed something, or she wants to say something, and she hasn't. And I thought she was guilty. She felt like in some way she'd failed her partner because she hadn't been able to see them through this illness that they'd had, and I really felt this, and I pitched it to her, and she you know had a very cathartic sort of emotional outburst, upset, and said, "How did you know that? How could you know that? I've never told anybody that." And there was some validation there for sure, a reward in as much that I'd had a breakthrough, but there was also a reward that I felt I really had sensed that, and I thought, just every now and again it's useful to try and think that you're actually trying to make a wee bit of a difference, and I felt I made a real difference, because actually the next time we met, we were able to move on from that and explore that, and I felt that we helped crack this particular lady's situation on the back of that little empathic gamble that I had the time before, and it kind of validated to me that I had something to offer, but I also felt I really helped her move on.
They're emotionally moving stories. I wonder, do you feel, we talked about this with Tom last week a lot, about how talking about mental health helps. So when you're saying you're talking with this lady about her problems with her grief and whatnot, do you feel one of the main reasons, for example, there's a stigma around mental health is because we are unable or unwilling in some ways to talk about it?
Yeah.
As we would with a physical illness,
yeah,
for example.
We can't see it, we can't quantify it.
Mm-hmm.
The first song that we have today, Handle With Care, I wrote a paper about it, and in that I said that mental health nurses have to learn, if they don't, very few of us have the innate ability to do this straight away, I guess, but we learn as we engage with people that you have to actually handle people emotional problems with every bit the same degree of gentleness, sensitivity, regard. I called it emotional dexterity in the paper, an expression borrowed from psychology, but and it's actually harder, if somebody's got a painful body part or a very nasty wound or something, you know that you have to be very, very careful of how you manually handle that individual. Learning how to tactfully, sensitively, gently handle somebody's damaged self, their damaged emotions, is a whole new and very hard to see skill set. And of course, you don't know how people will react often. And so I think that adds to the stigma, because you have a kind of, people have an experience, and there's a context around that experience. And as somebody who's trying to be a therapist or a nurse to someone, you have to try and understand that context and experience. People who don't have that window on mental health and mental health problems can actually just be terrified by that, I think, and that probably contributes to the stigma.
Okay. Wow, great. Well, on that, should we let that soak in whilst we listen to Handle With Care?
Show me that you really care. Everybody got somebody to lean on. Put your body next to mine and dream on. I've been uptight and made a mess, but I'll clean it up myself, I guess. Oh, the sweet smell of success. And
that was the Travelling Wilbies, is that right?
Yeah.
Did they have a special place in your heart?
Yeah, well, they're kind of super group, aren't they? They're made up of various superstars who had careers before they were there. They only made two albums because Roy Orbison sadly died at the end of the second album, which was called Travelling Wilburys 3. And they all adopted pseudonyms with the name Wilbury in it. So,
it's a fantastic name.
Yeah. So, I think, sadly, quite a number of them are dead now. So, George Harrison's also dead. So,
But their music still gets played on it.
Yeah, their music's still great.
So, I'm just wanting to, I guess, move on to ask you along the lines of how we all know that mental health is indiscriminate. It affects us all. And I just want to ask, how much of that have you witnessed throughout your career?
Well, mental health is no respecter of class or background or even of culture. How we characterise it in different cultures is perhaps different. But in a westernised idea, we have a rather medicalised view, a diagnostic view of mental health, moving into mental illness. And That's come under challenge, I guess, in the last generation or so, that we're looking at a much more interactional, relational kind of view of mental health and distress, and not just thinking about it as diagnosable illness, but even in government statistics, say that about one in four of us will have a diagnosable mental illness at some point in our life, which is quite high. I don't know how accurate that is, but an appreciable number of people will suffer from an appreciable level of distress, and of course all of us can experience the normal ebb and flow of mental well-being, where our mental well-being is disrupted and we respond contextually to the problem, like grief, as we talked about earlier, for example, or disappointment, and that can actually be very sad or very angry or very frustrated, and we're not diagnosably mentally unwell, but our equilibrium is disrupted in some way. So I think it touches a lot more people, but people are frightened of it, which is, I think, also part of the stigma. And in other cultures, they view mental health in alternative ways. Sometimes possession states are sometimes identified in some cultures, and even the remedies, if you like, for these problems would be controversial in the West. And sometimes they coexist alongside traditional westernised medicine. So people have traditional belief systems, but they're taking medications or having hospital admissions in some of these cultures where this happens. So it's a very interesting field and still very underexplored and indeed contentious. And we even have contention increasingly in westernised economies because we're challenging the supremacy of the medical model. As a sole explanation for what people experience as mental ill health.
Can I then ask you, since we kind of touched on Western views of mental health, what changes do you feel you've witnessed in the mental health profession or mental health services within Scotland and as the UK as a whole?
Yeah. The biggest change is I suppose that some of the demographic issues We've many more people living longer and having very appreciable mental health problems in late life. Dementia gets a lot of prominence, and quite rightly so. We have an aging population, so we're, and of course it's contentious as to whether mental health is a dementia is a mental health problem at all. It's a neurological condition that manifests itself with mental health difficulties. But equally, there's a very appreciable incidence of depression and anxiety in late life, and it's often undiagnosed and poorly managed and poorly understood. So that's been a big change, is the sort of the specialism around old age mental health problems. And I suppose the other big change has been the end of the asylum system and the closure of the large Victorian institutions, which were all retracted and shrinking in size, with very much fewer hospitals in Scotland than we did even 20 years ago. And we have new facilities, inpatient areas that are smaller, they're more human, ensuite single room accommodation, away from the big dormitories. People don't stay in hospital nearly so long, they certainly don't stay in for decades any longer, and we have very few patients who have had that kind of, if you like, psychiatric career now. And people might have a lifelong struggle with their mental health problems or with their illness, but their arena for care is increasingly the community, and the community is increasingly more accepting, if not fully accepting, of mental health and distress within it. We talked a wee bit before, one of the big changes that we've seen is the increase in prominence of substance influence in mental ill health, particularly drug-induced psychosis. A lot of admissions are often have either a dual diagnosis where somebody's abusing a substance alongside a mental health problem, or the substance itself has caused a mental health loss for the person. And I'm thinking in particular of cannabis, or I'm thinking in particular of the long-term effects, psychological effects of alcohol. So these are big changes.
Would like to ask is, how do you view, say, hospital admission then for mental health problems? Do you view it as the beginning of recovery, or do you view it as the first step to beginning recovery? Just given that talking to a few friends that I've known who have been admitted for those problems, they have either found it very difficult or even in some cases slightly traumatic. But at the same time, it's a strange structure position. They didn't like it, but it was necessary in order for them to begin their road to recovery.
Yeah, I think there's two things there. One is there's an issue around when hospital admission is required, the genie's out of the bottle. A person can be living and indeed be receiving treatment in the community, and actually maybe nobody else might know part of the people involved in it. Once somebody's in hospital, other people are going to know, you know, a wider, you know, they're no longer in their home. Other people have to know, they'll begin to receive visitors from outside, people begin to form a view on what might be wrong with the person, rightly or wrongly. So it's a traumatic step, because what was maybe private before becomes no less than semi-private thereafter. But also there's a chance for other people to acknowledge that they can be there for people and help them. So it might be the beginning of some acceptance from people in their circle, their own social and family circles. The person might be something that they've hidden before. They may be able to accept that they need help, and they might be able to see that admission is the start of a process of wider recovery. I suppose the challenge to that is that admission is often seems to come along hand in hand with either a legal statute that might enforce treatment, which might be traumatic for people, and medical treatment, medication in particular, which some people find very controversial, in terms of the wider concept of recovery, some people see a rejection of sort of imposed medication, those kinds of treatments, and say, well, that's the antithesis of recovery. It's very much a treatment. It's an imposed intervention, if you like. But equally, the medication may give somebody some peace of mind in order that they're able to enact their own version of recovery.
Yeah. Mm. So in terms of the current treatment that's on offer at the moment for mental illness, what do you feel are the pros or the good points of it, and what do you feel are future improvements or improvements that should be made?
Well, I think there's been an increasing place on talk-based therapies across certainly the UK. Improving access to psychological therapies is an initiative in England, and although we don't have it in Scotland, we're signed up to the spirit and principle of it.
Yeah.
So there's an awful lot more availability of talk-based therapies, practice counsellors, cognitive behavioural therapy available compared to before. There's also an emergent evidence base potentially around people who have psychosis, if they have a response from medication, adding CBT with these people seems to perhaps improve their outcomes.
What would that be, sorry? What would CBT be?
Cognitive behavioural therapy.
Okay.
Yeah. And so it does seem that people who have improved might have improved outcomes if they have met a sort of coalition of a traditional sort of medical approach and an interactional approach. We've also seen there was a review of nursing in Scotland in 2006, and one of the things that came out of that when they asked people who used services was that the presence of a confiding informed other was seen by people who use services as one of the single best interventions that they could have, and they often identified that single confiding informed other was a nurse. But it might be somebody else, but they identified that it was often a nurse who was particularly involved in the care or who particularly understood their situation. So, so I think that's a big change, is that the opportunity and the place and value of interaction, and then the person's own power to enact their recovery and make choices and to be involved in their care, has come rather than a paternalistic doing for people and doing unto people.
You've touched on it briefly already, I'd just like to ask more about what you feel, or what shift you feel there's been in recent years in demands for certain types of mental health services. So has there been more of a demand for, as I've talked to you before, this interview before, in say anxiety services than there was in the last 20 years, say, or what have you witnessed yourself?
Yeah, I think we know that there's a massive increase in the prescription of antidepressants.
Mm-hmm.
Does that mean that depression is radically on the rise, or does it mean that people are less stigmatised or traumatised by the concept of feeling less than optimal, feeling anxious, feeling depressed, or feeling an agitated depression that kind of combines the two? Are they more likely to present because they feel that there's help available, and it's people will be much less judged if they do seek treatments for these things? And we do also see the presence of practice counsellors emerging, of psychology assistants who are typically psychology graduates who are trained up in some specific modalities of treatment, like cognitive behavioural therapy or solution-focused brief therapy, to provide a fairly short duration treatment for some acute mental problems.
Mm-hmm.
So we are seeing an increasing range of available approaches, and people do seem to be more ready to ask for help for these fairly common. Are they more common? I don't know. Is it just, or we do have a high tariff stress life out there these days, and for a financial crash, there's we have a have society, I must have that. We have a high achieving society. We have. So does that pressurise people, and so therefore we have more of these stress-related anxiety and depressive problems? I don't know. I think certainly part of this, though, is that people are more willing to seek help for these problems, not hide in quite the way that we used to.
Well, would you like to give us your second soundtrack?
Yeah, the second song is Everybody Hurts by REM, which... I actually don't know the story behind the song, but it does suggest that there are times when every one of us can hurt emotionally, I think.
Great. Here we go.
day is long, and the night is yours alone. You're sure you've had enough this life. Yourself go. Cause everybody cries, everybody hurts sometimes everything is wrong. Time to sing along when your day is night. Hold on, hold on. Feel like letting go. You think you've had too much this life. Hang on.
REM, as would have been with a lot of people growing up. especially myself. But it's true, everyone does hurt, as strong as people might think, that, you know, in everything, every single way, we're a fragile animal.
Mm-hmm. We all need support something too.
Definitely.
So, I'm wanting to move on the questions to look at things a little bit in politics or current issues at the moment. So, I just want to ask your current views on the cuts that the mental health services, mental health sector are facing at the moment, because we're looking at, for example, in the last 4 years, we've seen 80 million cut from the current mental health budget, 35 million of that alone this year. Can I ask what your views are on that?
Well, at a time when mental health is an increasing prominence in, if you like, in the healthcare marketplace,
mm-hmm.
cuts of any kind are a challenge. Challenge is a euphemism for a problem, I think, sometimes. We have also seen a massive reduction in bed availability, and sometimes there's a lot of steam blown off about the availability of beds, but actually if you need a bed, that's a challenge. There is also quite a divide between what's going on in England and what's going on in Scotland, because the NHS in Scotland is a devolved aspect of political life in Scotland, and so health services do work in slightly different ways, including mental health services.
Yeah.
And there probably have been retractions or cutbacks there as well. We've seen a much more gradated move towards reducing the bed numbers in Scotland, with some concomitant investment in community services. I can't talk too much about England, but I know there's a huge amount of prominence. We were talking just briefly there about how Jeremy Corbyn appointed a Minister for Mental Health, but so did Nicola Sturgeon a year ago when she became First Minister. She appointed Jamie Hepburn. He's got a longer title because he's responsible for sport and communities and mental health, but it was still the first time that mental health appeared in a ministerial brief overtly, rather than being somewhat just subsumed within the Minister of Health role.
Mm-hmm.
And that was an important change in both regards. I think I think Nick Clegg, before the general election, made
a
promise of a big investment in mental health services,
mm-hmm.
which, because of the changing colour of the UK government, won't be enacted. But it was still important that people have seen this as a political worthy discussion point beyond health of itself.
Yeah.
And so the cuts do damage, because if you reduce choice and you reduce availability of service, you end up coming back perhaps to people either struggling without the services that they need, or you end up with people relying solely on medication. And as I said earlier, one of the advances that I thought had been made was the availability of choice for people. So yeah, I think that there are some implications for anything when there's a cut, and I think those are some of the implications for cuts in mental health.
So I guess you've touched on it just there, but what issues do you think then the mental health sector is facing in the next few generations then?
I think an increasing restructuring of the service, or the services that we offer, and particularly as what we have is, you know, sort of medium stay or to longer stay, and bed provision being taken away. That's a change. Now there's an arena of contention there as to whether taking away long stay beds actually is a good thing, because you're not institutionalising people, they're not becoming reliant on an inpatient experience, they're being restored to the community in some way. That might be a normally a good thing. The problem is, if someone needs a bed and there isn't one, that is a challenge. I suppose we've seen some things locally, I think the jury's still out as to how this is working, but we used to have intensive psychiatric inpatient care in Angus, Dundee and Perth, and we now, the intensive psychiatric care unit is only in Dundee now. It's quite a small unit. So you used to have, if you needed a very secure environment to be cared for when you're acutely distressed, you could have that, you know, more local to home. That provision is now in one place. But there might be a good thing in there, because it actually means that people stay in the intensive psychiatric care unit only as long as they actually require it, rather than becoming stuck in a place. So you know, there's a pro and cons, a balance to be achieved in how you provide care. You know, just because you had a bed doesn't mean you have to use it. So perhaps the I think it's 10 beds in the ward at Carfew. Obviously it's very sparing. The people who are there are the people who really need to be there.
Do you feel there's a particular area within the mental health sector, either currently or probably in the future, or maybe in the future, that either the Scottish Government or the Westminster Government need to invest in more?
I think there has to be continued investment in supporting recovery initiatives. You know, recovery's been around in UK mental health services as an ethos, as a choice for emerging from mental distress for, you know, the better part of 20 years now. And so we need to continue to support those kind of initiatives where people want to enact their own personal choice of how to live their life through their problems. So I think there needs to be some investment there. We are going to need to continue investing in mental health services for older people, as we should celebrate the fact that people live longer, healthier lives, but I have to acknowledge that with that comes a cost to physical and to emotional health. We need to continue to invest in those types of services and continue to think about offering people choice by offering them interactional therapies as well as traditional medicine.
You touched on it quite a bit in a few, a lot of your answers, but I think it would maybe be quite good if the listeners could hear what types of different mental health services there are. So you mentioned hospital, you mentioned community, the support groups. Can you explain a few of them to us, please?
Well, I think most people have an idea that, you know, you can get mental health care at your GP. That's still a very good first port of call, but increasingly services are built in the community that will take an open referral, so you can refer yourself without going to your GP first, you know, you say. Particularly if people have been unwell before and they know the markers that suggest that their mental health is deteriorating, they can refer and either have an increase in the service they existingly receive or re-engage with service. So I think that's an important thing. Increasingly, in the political context, we're having an integrated approach to healthcare with health and social care, so that community mental health teams are usually integrated, and they'll often offer a range of domestic supports, clinic type supports, or indeed day services where you can go and have group therapies. There's also an increasing engagement with the third sector, the voluntary sector in particular, who offer certain inputs that maybe aren't available in the NHS, like very specific group supports or peer support group inputs. And I'm thinking in particular places like in addictions, that those kinds of third sector provisions are really helpful in offering choice beyond the statutory services.
Can I move on slightly in a wee bit of a different direction here and ask you something we asked Tom Garrett last week? And, can I ask, do you feel there's a difference between men and women in seeking help for mental health issues, or seeking support even?
There are some differences. Some illnesses are more common in one gender over another. Typically, schizophrenia as a diagnosis is more prevalent amongst men, it's more prevalent amongst people from a more working class type background as well. We know that there are probably more women present with anxiety and depression than men. We're not sure whether that's because women are more likely to open up to their friends and actually seek help for that, or if the demography is really that much different, but statistically that seems to be the case. So there do seem to be differences between the sexes. If you look at forensic mental health care, where people have had involvement with the law as a result of mental illness or become mentally ill as a result of contact with the custodial services, over 90% of the patients are men.
Wow.
So there's a very graphic gender difference there. So offending with mental health seems
to be. Why do you think there is such a huge number?
I actually can't entirely answer that. I know there are some theories around anger and violence and management, and sexual offending, for example, is much more typically carried out by men than by women. So that some of those things might play to that.
Maybe because it's a societal thing then.
It could be, but I think the figures are somewhat similar in other countries as well.
Yeah.
Forensic mental health services are principally services for men, but not exclusively so.
Yeah. Okay.
So there are some gender differences, and how much of that's due to people, how they seek help or how they engage with services, and how much is actually to do with the condition being specific to the genders is a moot point that I'm not necessarily qualified to fully answer.
No, I don't. I know I was kind of throwing you in the deep end there, but. I might be throwing you in the deep end again, but with this one, but like, what effect? Maybe you've seen it yourself, even through your own work or through lecturing also. But what effect do you feel these differences that you've spoken about have on women, but especially men, given that there's quite a disparity?
Mm-hmm.
Like in seeking support and whatnot.
I think one of the things that you can see, another big gender difference, is the prevalence of suicide. Like Scotland has its highest cause of death in younger men is suicide, which is an absolute tragedy at any time, but a particular tragedy when we're talking about so many. And is it because they can't talk about the problems? Mm-hmm. Do we have a cultural socialisation around boys that they have to tough it out? I like to think that's changing, but the figures still suggest that, in fact, many more men take their life than women in our society, especially younger, at a younger age. So that's a particular challenge. And Scotland does have a particularly high suicide rate compared to the rest of the UK. It did rise in England for the first time in a few years, but it's stayed fairly high in Scotland. We're not quite the worst in Europe for suicide. Poland and Hungary and Finland have higher rates, but we're higher than the rest of the UK and Scotland. So that's that's an issue that's worried commissioners, politicians, and professionals for some time, as to how do we crack that particular conundrum, and we're still wrestling with that. Mm-hmm.
So I guess you've just touched on it there, but do you feel like there's being enough done to tackle this problem, or do you feel it's a sort of silent epidemic in our culture that we're not really speaking about?
There's a lot of initiatives going on out there, assist training. We have it here in the university, the caring professions. The union has trained assist counsellors or workers. We've tried education and with younger people in colleges and schools and universities beyond being a service provision by mental health services, and still things remain high. So I don't think there's a sort of linear answer to it, but there does seem to be a difference about how men seek help when they're distressed.
Yeah.
And I suppose it's also worth mentioning that 70% of people who complete suicide actually are not engaged with mental health services at that point. They're obviously acutely distressed at the point at which they make a very, very pivotal decision, but they're not engaged with services. Only about 30% of the people who complete suicide are actually seen by mental health services.
Mm. So that's a shocking statistic. Yeah. Wow. Goodness sakes.
Something more to think about. Your thoughts on?
Well, I see you've got the next song queued up, which I think is about suicide, ironically enough. it's a very dark song. It's a very powerful song called Evanescence.
Why did you choose it?
Oh, I don't know. I find it very sad to listen to it. I don't know, the whole album is quite dark, actually. My Immortal is another particularly strong and dark track on the on the album, so there is a kind of there's a whole kind of emo feel to the to the album. It's actually the first album I ever bought in the United States. Actually bought it on holiday because was it Wake Me Up Inside? That was sort of a big hit at the time, and so I bought the album in Walmart. So, but I spent a lot of time listening to this, and you know, people who are like, you know, oh, that song's depressing, but I said, well, I think there's a message in it. You know?
Yeah, I can remember her saying the girl that sings it, Amy something, I can't remember her surname now, but I know when I was 15, but I think she wrote about her own experiences with depression and various, and I think it's just a contribution of the band's own experiences, but I can't remember correctly, but
Well, here we go. Hello by Evanescence. Evanescence with Hello. Very poignant song. And we were talking about happier things.
Yeah.
I guess I've got a bit of a question. So we're talking about immunity from mental health, and you're a professional. How would you deal with if you kind of, you know, when the equilibrium's off, how do you kind of...
Well, there's many a mental health nurse themselves have become mentally unwell, mm-hmm. and so that's, you know, that happens. There's an instance of people who care for people with mental health problems who develop their own. We also have an instance of people who have had mental health difficulties and experience of services who come in to be nurses to mm-hmm. add that layer of context to their care and experience, which can be quite helpful at times. The usual ways that mental health nurses have been supported to try and avoid becoming unwell themselves is in recent years we've had the advent of clinical supervision in nursing, and I think it's no mistake or no accident that probably clinical supervision is an activity which is not just a supervisor activity on how you perform in your job, it's a restorative and developmental activity if it's carried out properly. Has been embraced more in mental health, and particularly more in community mental health than perhaps mm-hmm. other areas of nursing, and I think that's because people value the ability to discharge how they feel about challenges that they've encountered emotionally at work, about how to grow through them,
mm-hmm.
and about feeling supported without feeling embarrassed to say, you know, this has been an emotional challenge for me, mm-hmm. That was really difficult for me. And we've also got a sort of provenance within mental health now of post-incident debrief,
mm-hmm.
where if there's a very aggressive incident at work or there is a suicide, there is availability of a resource to speak to someone about how you feel if you've been intimately involved
mm-hmm.
In that, rather than just bottling it up and compartmentalising
yeah.
it and having a clinical detachment about
yeah.
it. There is actually an opportunity to discharge that now. Despite that, there are still high pressure jobs.
Yeah.
There are still, we all have different resiliences. You talked about immunity to mental health. Nobody's immune to it. We all learn to be resilient in different ways to different challenges
mm-hmm.
in life, and some folk build up some resiliences. The other thing important is that just for mental health, nurse like everyone else, it's important
mm-hmm.
to get away from the job sometimes.
Yeah.
Or it's important to do something different within the job so they have,
yeah.
have role diversity, so that the job is not all about extremely high tariff care all the time.
Mm-hmm.
And internal rotation to different kinds of teams can be important, and particularly in the hospital, and moving people to different kinds of clinical environments can be helpful as well. Although that's harder to do as hospitals are much smaller now, so the range of clinical specialties that are available in patient are less. But so there are a number of things, but I don't think anyone's immune. And
yeah.
Mental health nurses themselves are not immune to the rigors of mental distress.
That's great. I think it's important to know, obviously.
Yeah, definitely. Because I think I know from even talking to mental health nurses I know as family friends, they've left jobs in the past because it's become too difficult, because there hadn't been the support there in the past,
mm-hmm.
really, for when things like suicides and whatnot within the job happened. So it's definitely an improvement, I guess, I would
mm-hmm.
say, too. Just continuing on the theme of, I guess, life as a mental health nurse, what advice would you give to anyone that's thinking about either becoming a mental health nurse, either as a postgraduate or even an undergraduate again?
Well, the advice is to probably find out, to think very deeply about why you want to be a mental health nurse, and your first buzz in mental health nursing has to be around people. I guess that applies to nursing, but the main route to intervention is you as a nurse, rather than, you know, a machine, a technical procedure. It's about your engagement and communication skills. So we have a mantra in the School of Nursing that, and it's more than a punchline,
yeah.
that we want people to care with commitment, compassion and curiosity.
Mm-hmm.
And you have to look inside yourself and see whether you have the wherewithal to be compassionate with people's emotions.
Mm-hmm.
I think you can learn elements of compassion, but I think
yeah.
you also have to some extent come with a sense of what it is to care for another,
mm-hmm.
particularly in this emotional, interactional
yeah.
role. You have to be committed to understanding the complexities of human being and being prepared to, if you like, get your hands dirty with
mm-hmm.
The emotional side of care, both to be able to listen to to the patient's story, but also to be able to learn the skills to feed that back to people, so that they can tap into their own strengths and learn new skills and have new awarenesses that will help them grow out of their problems, or to manage their own problems more effectively. And then the last part, you have to be curious about people. You have to want to know about them. And you have to want to know about them and not just say, well, this is a quick fix. You have to be prepared to engage with people in some depth and over time.
Mm-hmm.
And so it's more than a mantra, it's something that we actually believe.
Yeah. Is there any particular, say, work experience you'd encourage in order to understand, but...
Working, you know, volunteering with a mental health charity or a friend in service, or working in, even in the care homes where, and even although the care can sometimes be rather physical, when it's older people, a lot of physical, intimate personal care, people still need to be cared for emotionally, and sometimes sadly that can be overlooked.
Mm-hmm.
And also the people who've given up the care of a loved one to a care home environment have a lot of mental tensions around that. There's sometimes guilt, there's sometimes concern, there's sometimes fear.
Mm-hmm.
So there's a lot of opportunity sometimes to support the people who are the carers and the families of people who go into nursing home care. So it's more than just, you know, the daily grind of meeting people's physical care needs. We should actually be much more acutely aware of their emotional compassion needs as well, and there's opportunities there to perhaps learn some of that. I don't think it's necessarily the proving ground that David Cameron thought it was when he said everyone should have a year in a care home before they become a nurse, but it's not an unhelpful experience, and it also gives people something to contextualise what they then learn in university.
What advice would you then give to newly qualified mental health nurses? Hello. Or who are about to graduate then?
With regard to
working in the NHS, working in the mental health sector?
You know, be prepared to change. I would say that to any nurse, but mental health services are evolving. They have evolved in my 30 years associated with mental health care. They've evolved fairly radically. The shift will increasingly be to the community, so be prepared to change. Be prepared to be to have a continuous professional development, a lifelong learning ethos.
Mm-hmm.
We talk about that, but again, and we've talked about it for a long time, but I think it's absolutely essential. One, it keeps your own thinking fresh, it gives you new perspectives, and it probably helps you be more resilient to the change and perhaps to some of the emotional burdens that you perhaps share and even shoulder sometimes in the job, because you give yourself an opportunity to recharge your batteries with new learning.
What advice then, also then, just looking at the opposite end of the spectrum, would you give to your first year mental health nursing students at the moment here in Dundee for the course that they're doing?
Yeah, the mental health's everyone's business. We compartmentalise it, but you know, people are become mentally unwell, but they're people and they have other problems. And so try to think as in a person-centred, or it's a bit of a strap line, but in as much of a holistic way as you can about the person. That the person who's got principally mental health problems might neglect their physical health because of that.
Mm-hmm.
And so we have to think about people in a much more person-centred, individualised way. Equally, if someone's in a general hospital, we have to think about what their emotional support needs or their overt mental health care needs might be in that environment as well. So be prepared to have a wider view that mental health is not just compartmentalised to mental health services, that people have care needs in all care arenas. Mm-hmm.
Can I just ask you finally, what's your message to any students who are either experiencing mental health, either with themselves or with others they care for?
If they seek help, they should be prepared to be able to say anything to the professionals that they engage with, because the professionals have probably heard most things.
Mm-hmm.
they've not heard them from this person about this person's life, but they're there and ready to hear what they have to say. And the first step to recovery is to sharing the problem. It's not a problem shared as a problem halved,
mm-hmm.
but it's a problem shared as a problem that's now available for someone to help you with. And so the first port of call is to seek help from someone.
Fantastic.
Mm. That was great. Very insightful.
Brilliant.
And I really appreciate it. But you have one last song, and this is a bit of a change of direction and language.
Yes, this is Croc na Féile from Rundrig, which is a Gaelic song. And it's a very upbeat song, and I picked it because Gaelic music improves my mood. So.
Fantastic. Well, let's improve everyone's mood. Here's Rundrig.
Yeah.